Myths of Japan, narrated by Jonathan Waite. The Jellyfish and the Monkey, adapted by Yei Theodora Ozaki. Long, long ago, in old Japan, the Kingdom of the Sea was governed by a wonderful king. He was called Rinjin, or the Dragon King of the Sea. His power was immense, for he was the ruler of all sea creatures, both great and small. And in his keeping were the jewels of the ebb and flow of the tide. The jewel of the ebbing tide, when thrown into the ocean, caused the sea to recede from the land. And the jewel of the flowing tide made the waves rise to mountains high and to flow in upon the shore like a tidal wave. The palace of Rinjin was at the bottom of the sea, and was so beautiful that no one has ever seen anything like it, even in dreams. The walls were of coral, the roof of jade stone and chalcedony, and the floors were of the finest mother of pearl. But the Dragon King, in spite of his wide-spreading kingdom, his beautiful palace and all its wonders, and his power, which none disputed throughout the whole sea, was not at all happy, for he reigned alone. At last he thought that if he married he would not only be happier, but also more powerful. So he decided to take a wife. Calling all his fish retainers together, he chose several of them as ambassadors to go through the sea and seek for a young dragon princess who would be his bride. At last they returned to the palace, bringing with them a lovely young dragon. Her scales were of a glittering green, like the wings of summer beetles. Her eyes threw out glances of fire, and she was dressed in gorgeous robes. All the jewels of the sea worked in with the embroidery adorned them. The king fell in love with her at once, and the wedding ceremony was celebrated with great splendor. Every living thing in the sea, from the great whales down to the little shrimps, came in shoals to offer their congratulations to the bride and bridegroom and to wish them a long and prosperous life. Never had there been such an assemblage or such gay festivities in the fish world before. The train of bearers who carried the bride's possessions to her new home seemed to reach across the waves from one end of the sea to the other. Each fish carried a phosphorescent lantern and was dressed in ceremonial robes, gleaming blue and pink and silver, and the waves as they rose and fell and broke that night seemed to be rolling masses of white and green fire, for the phosphorus shone with double brilliancy in honor of the event. Now for a time the Dragon King and his bride lived very happily. They loved each other dearly, and the bridegroom day after day took delight in showing his bride all the wonders and treasures of his coral palace. And she was never tired of wandering with him through its vast halls and gardens. Life seemed to them both like a long summer's day. 2 months passed in this happy way, and then the Dragon Queen fell ill and was obliged to stay in bed. The king was sorely troubled when he saw his precious bride so ill, and at once sent for the fish doctor to come and give her some medicine. He gave her special orders to the servants to nurse her carefully and to wait upon her with diligence. But in spite of all the nurse's assiduous care and the medicine that the doctor prescribed, the young queen showed no signs of recovery, but grew daily worse. Then the Dragon King interviewed the doctor and blamed him for not curing the queen. The doctor was alarmed at Rinjin's evident displeasure, and excused his want of skill by saying that, although he knew the right kind of medicine to give the invalid, it was impossible to find it in the sea. "Do you mean to tell me that you can't get the medicine here?" asked the Dragon King. "It is just as you say," said the doctor. "Tell me what is it you want for the queen?" demanded Rinjin. "I want the liver of a live monkey," answered the doctor. "The liver of a live monkey? Of course that will be most difficult to get," said the king. "If we could only get that for the queen, Her Majesty would soon recover," said the doctor. "Very well, that decides it. We must get it somehow or other. But where are we most likely to find a monkey?" asked the king. Then the doctor told the Dragon King that some distance to the south there was a monkey island where a great many monkeys lived. "If only you could capture one of those monkeys," said the doctor. "How can any of my people capture a monkey?" said the Dragon King, greatly puzzled. "The monkeys live on dry land, while we live in the water, and out of our element we are quite powerless. I don't see what we can do." "That has been my difficulty too," said the doctor. "But amongst your innumerable servants, you surely can find one who can go on shore for that express purpose?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.